think it was already the winter, early 39, when I went to New York on a vacation and happened to be taken to see the Cradle Will Rock at the Labor Stage on 41st Street, and was just freaked out by it. I thought it was the most wonderful thing I'd ever seen in the theater. Totally new and original.
Now listen, you Black Legions, you Ku Kluxers, you vigilantes hiding up there in the cradle of the Liberty Committee. When the storm breaks, the cradle will fall.
Make the world safe for democracy, make the world safe for liberty, make the world safe for Steel and the Mr. Family.
Of course, it's peace we're for. This is war to end all war. Amen.
I can see the market rising like a beautiful bird.
Collection.
Your guests are disgusting. Your food is too heavy. We eat and we drink and we belch and we're full and we're ill and we're bored.
You boys will kill me.
There never was such a day or such a night time. There never was such a boy as we will have, and all in the right time.
I wrote The Cradle Will Rock, both the words and the music at white heat during 5 weeks in 1936.
At that moment, I was directing radio, getting a full $33 a week on WPA. We were all starving. $30 a week.
Its first paid public performance provided one of the most curious and spectacular evenings in the history of the American theater.
The Cradle Will Rock was the third production of the Federal Theater of the WPA's Project 891. And this was run by Orson Welles and myself.
And Mark and Orson did a whole flirtatious seduction of me. I was the only possible man who could play Larry Foreman. When I left that interview, I was on, you know, on air, and very happily I reduced my salary from $33 to $23.86, which was the actor's salary at the time. Lovely time, lovely live time in theater. The Vital 30s, called by many the Vital 30s. Gorgeous time. And this play, and Mark's work, is an expression of that love and that vitality.
Story? Is that what your papers want? A story? Listen.
It was the connection between the Vital 30s and the production of those 30s and the early American time. You had really people like Jefferson, then Adams, the passion of Adams and the rest. And there was a connection between that passion and vitality of those early years and the lovely Vital 30s, of which Cradle is a part, a fearless time, and a time of an expression of true ideals.
Worker gets gypped for no good reason, just gypped. From the start until the finish comes, they feed him out of garbage cans, they breed him in the slums. Joe Worker will go to shops where stuff is on show. He'll look at the meat, he'll look at the bread, and too little to eat sort of goes to the head. One big question inside me cries, how many fakers, peace undertakers, paid strike breakers, how many toiling, ailing, dying, piled up bodies, brother, does it take to make you wise? Joe Worker just drops right at his work and he drops. Weary, weary, tired to the core. And then if he drops out of sight, there's always plenty more. Joe Worker must know that somebody's got him in tow. Yet what is the good
For just one to be clear, oh, it takes a lot of Joes to make a sound you can hear. One big question inside me cries, how many frame-ups, how many shakedowns, lockouts, sellouts, how many times machine guns tell the same old story, brother, does it take to make
While we were rehearsing The Cradle Will Rock, it became evident, more and more evident, that this was a very hot property. It was about the rise of the CIO, it was about a steel strike, it was about the conflict between the establishment and the new forces within the labor movement.
I should like a series on young Larry Foreman, who goes around storming and organizing unions.
Yes, so we've heard of him. In fact, good word of him, he seems. Quite popular with working men.
Find out who he drinks with and talks with and sleeps with, and look up his past till at last you got it on him.
But the man is full of fight. He's simply dynamite. Why, it would take an army to tame him.
Then it shouldn't be too hard to frame him.
Oh, the press, the press, the freedom of the press. You've only got a hint, whatever's free to print. If something's wrong with it, well, then we'll print to fit. With a hey diddle dee and a ho nanny no, for whichever side will pay.
The frame-up is used by Mark, as it was used at the time, as a weapon against the organizing workers.
You the guy who runs this joint?
I'm the proprietor.
You know a Polack who comes in here every Sunday?
A Polack?
Sure, a punk. With his wife, he comes here.
Oh, you mean the Polish fella?
He brings his wife here every week, about this time. She likes my ice cream sodas. Yes, I know them well.
You know what he looks like, huh?
Yes, why?
You like to keep this drugstore, wouldn't you? You wouldn't want any company to clamp down on the mortgage or anything like that now, would you?
What's the idea?
Here's the dough. When that Polack comes in here today, you don't say nothing. He goes out, there's a big noise outside. You don't say nothing. Nothing, understand? You keep your trap shut. Later on, when they ask you who done it, you remember, it's this here Polack.
Done what?
Explosion and taking a little piece off of Union headquarters across the street.
Who is?
None of your damn business. Jeez, I don't know what a boss had to pick you out of all the stores on this side. Talk about dumb. Listen, I go over it all again. There's gonna be an explosion. And this guy's gonna be in the explosion. He ain't gonna bother you none after that.
And his wife, too.
Can I help it if his wife never lets him out of her sight? Shut up, here they come now.
At first, we'd really just thought it was an exciting theater piece. Then, as the little steel strikes began to spread all over the country and labor unrest in a very big way swept the country, we realized that this was a firecracker. The federal government and the WPA administration came to the same conclusion just about the same time as we did.
And we weren't permitted to perform it.
We had, by the way, given one final huge dress rehearsal with an orchestra of 28 pieces and tons of sceneries.
But Orson's production was so splendiferous. It frightened the hell out of all of us actors, you know. The stage, when we said The Cradle Will Rock, the whole stage rocked back and forth with lightning shooting out of people's behinds everywhere.
But immediately after that, they padlocked the theater and forbade us to move. We defied all this and invited the public, which was gathering in large numbers, scenting some kind of brouhaha, had gathered outside the theater. We invited them to join us uptown. We'd rented a theater for the night on 59th Street.
We all took the audience up Broadway.
By bus, by taxi, on foot. They arrived there, and by 8:30, the theater was full. The actors were not allowed on stage, and they sat around in the audience. We didn't exactly know where they were, but we knew that they were in the house.
Mark played it on the stage at the piano.
And to quote Mark,
there was I, myself,
produced by John Houseman, directed by Orson Welles, lit by Abe Fader, and conducted by Lehman Engel. But I started, ready to do the whole show myself.
Then came one of the most moving things that I can remember ever being present at in a theater.
I began singing the Moll's first song of the play.
I'm checking home now, call it a night, going up to my room.
Then I heard the words taken from my mouth by the Moll herself, seated in a right loge, and clever Fader promptly switched the spot to her.
I ain't in Steel Town long. I work 2 days a week. The other five, my efforts ain't required. For 2 days out of seven, $2 bills I'm given. So I'm just searching along the street, for on those 5 days it's nice to eat. Jesus, Jesus, who said let's eat.
And it was almost impossible at this distance in time to convey the throat-catching, sickeningly exciting quality of that moment, or to describe the emotions of gratitude and love with which we heard and saw that slim green figure.
The audience seethed with excitement. They turned, as at a tennis match, from one actor to another, while Fader caught as many performers as he could with his spotlight.
The formal charge is inciting to riot. Ain't you ever seen my egg? Well, I'm creeping along in the dark. My eyes is crafty, and my pockets is bulging. I'm loaded, armed to the teeth, with leaflets. And am I quick on the draw? I come up to you very slow, very sneaky, and with one fell gesture, I tuck a leaflet in your hand. Then one, two, three, there's a riot. You're the riot. I incited you. I'm terrific, I am.
People will say, well, I'm not sure that I understand exactly the political elements that gave birth to those 30s, the organization of the CIO and so on, the villains, Mr. and Mr. and so on, but something of the essential nature of the work, the passion, its battle against perfidy and corruption and stupidity. I think those elements are classic.
We're middle class. We all got property. We also got our eyes open. This crowd here, hiding up there in the cradle of the Liberty Committee. Upon the topmost bough of yonder tree now, like bees in their hives, the lords and their lackeys and wives, a swinging rockabye baby and a nice big cradle. Then they remark, the air is chilly up there, the sky beetle-browed, can that be a cloud over there? And then they put out their hands and feel stormy weather. A birdie ups and cries, boys, this looks bad. You haven't used your eyes, you wish you had. That's thunder, that's lightning, and it's going to surround you. No wonder those storm birds seem to circle around you. When you can't climb down and you can't sit still, that's a storm, it's going to last until the final wind blows. And when the wind blows, the cradle will rock.
And if in the next 2 hours, all the actors in the cast, with one or two exceptions, stood in the house, stood in boxes, stood in the aisles, ran around, changed their positions, sang songs, duets, separated by the whole width of the theater, did all kinds of extraordinary pieces of improvisation. And the net result of this was one of the most thrilling and extraordinary world premieres I've ever been at, or anyone has ever been at. And that is how The Cradle Will Rock was born.
It all seemed part of that progressive movement that we were all involved in the late 30s, and should be still but alas, too many of us aren't, which had to do with not only the subject matter of the Cradle Will Rock, unionization, but everything else, the rise of Hitler and anti-fascism, which we were all in together. And it occurred to me when I was thinking about talking with you today that I am now just about the age he was when he died. I'm 57 and about to be 58. And that is about his age when he died. I was a senior at Harvard, and I was determined to do the Cradle Will Rock, and we did. It was a wild success. We had to repeat it by demand, and that's when I met him. He saw the performance that night and was very much taken with it, and in a way saw himself, what would it be, 13 years younger. And I identified with him in a very strong way, because by that time I had the feeling I'd practically written this work myself. I knew it so well. And he became a kind of mentor of mine, as much in this field of theater as Aaron Copland had been in the field of absolute music. But there came a time when I was playing my music much more for Mark than for Aaron. I suppose the two areas in which you could say that he was most influential, not just on me, but on American musical theater in general, were, one, the area of using the popular song form as a building block. In other words, he could make very large forms, very big pieces, but always based on the pop song. Mark had been writing the Airborne Symphony during the war in England, where he was stationed, about flying in terms of the war. But it got bigger than that. It became a symphony, and I guess the only symphony he ever wrote.
It was a windy day in North Carolina. Windy and light. Sun was shining, air was cold and bright. Couple of brothers, the brothers Wright, stood around, gave orders, lent a hand. When out of its shed on the big gray field was wheeled the contraption, the construction, the plane. There you go.
Tremendously influenced by Mark in everything I wrote for the theater, and even in some things that weren't, because even in a work so enormous as my Mass, which is a 2 hours of nonstop music, the basic unit in it is always the song form, the pop song form, no matter how it's developed or stretched or distorted or snuck in and out of. And in that sense, I think I owe my greatest debt to Mark. And the other, second area, which is even more important, is that I think Mark was the, and still is, as far as I am concerned, the greatest master of the setting of the American language to music. For example, the very opening of The Cradle Will Rock, which is a famous opening, it's the Moll, this faded, sweet, frail, hopeless creature standing under a lamppost, waiting for some train to come by. And it starts like this, if you remember. She says, I'm checking home now, call it a night, going up to my room, turn off the light. Jesus, turn off that light. Now, all that would seem to be absolutely normal setting of the American language, except for one syllable, which is my. Going up to my room, you would say normally, I'm checking home now, call it a night, going up to my room, turn off the light, turn on the light. Jesus, turn off that light, right? But he says, going up to my room. Now that's a wrong accent, apparently, and you would immediately accuse him of having set those words wrong. But that's a deliberate wrong accent. You see, because he says, I'm checking home now, call it a night, going up to my room. That wrong accent happens to coincide with a sort of wrong note, right? Turn on the light. And in that combination of wrong note and wrong accent, syllabic accent, you get the whole sense of the wrongness and illiterateness and hopelessness of this girl. There's always a reason for these misplaced accents. And as I said before, the pop song form is the basis of everything he wrote, no matter how big it became. I'm going to try to remember a song of Mark's called Zipperfly. See if I can remember. There are a lot of words, but Mark always used to say when he sang it, he always forgot the words himself, and I would remind him, so he always said I knew the words better than he. Maybe I can remember, it's 15 or 20 years since I've sung this. I no longer have the range in my whiskey voice, but I'll try and sing it for you because it is a quintessential Blitzstein song. It's a little short story, really. It's a kind of musical vignette, which describes a 14-year-old shoeshine boy, very poor kid, who is saying his prayers before he goes to sleep. Ragamoochie, wicky wacky, and a woo, haggity goo. This should be an octave higher. Ragamoochie, wicky wacky, and a woo, haggity goo. My wishes are but few. I wish my wish come true. Ragamoochie, wicky wacky, and a woo, haggity goo. And the bodies of seven dead ants laid side by side, starlight, star bright, first star I've seen tonight. Grant me a suit with a form-fitting coat and a six-button vest and a zipper fly. It will not shrink when weather gets stormy, and no one ever wore it before me. Nothing could be so fine, a wonderful suit that was bought and paid for in a genuine store with a zipper fly. My dream tells me one day I will walk down Fifth Avenue. It will be Easter Sunday, maybe. People will stop me and nudge one another and say as they slyly give me the eye, who is that man in that wonderful suit that enchants
fitting you suit with the Zipperfly. Roozy goozy chicka chacky and a chew haggity goo. Roozy goozy chicka chacky and a chew haggity goo. A wish is so delish, I wish I get my wish. Roozy goozy chicka chacky and a chew haggity goo. And I call upon the seventh letter of the seventh word of the seventh paragraph of the editorial page of the Daily News. Grant me a suit with a form-fitting coat and a six-button vest and a Zipperfly. Oh, with what fearful pleasure I'd wear it. I'd be so beautiful, I can't bear it. Nothing could be so fine. And please make that suit with a modified pig cuff and a high waist effect and a Zipperfly. If you had six brothers with their old hand-me-downs left to you, you would know what I'm wishing for. And please make that suit with a pepper and salt pattern and a little place for flowers and a Zipperfly. Now I lay me down asleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep, and if before I wake I should die, please lay me out in my wonderful suit, my unspeakable suit, with a Zipperfly.
That marvelous? One of the things that bothers me about Mark Blitzstein since his death is the rapidity with which his name has been forgotten. It's just heartbreaking, because the effect that he has had on American musical theater is incalculable.
The plains.
Not without grief. Not without warning. Without warning. Warning. Warning.